have the pleasure of introducing our speaker tonight because unfortunately Mrs. Broderick is down with pneumonia. She wasn't able to be here tonight, and she wants you to know how incredibly disappointed she was that she couldn't be with you, because she was really excited to bring our speaker here tonight, Dr. Cassidy Freitas, who has a private practice. She's a licensed in family and marriage counseling, and has her specialty is in treating people with stress and anxiety of all ages, and she's here to do a presentation tonight. So Cassidy, yeah.
Thank you. My name is Dr. Cassidy Freitas. As she said, I have a private practice here in San Diego where I work with individuals from all ages and all walks of life, but I do work a lot with children and adolescents and their families. In particular, children and adolescents struggling with anxiety. And Megan Broderick and I trained together, so I know your guidance counselor very well. She's so wonderful, and I'm so grateful she asked me to join all of you today. I also teach part-time at the University of San Diego, so for any of you who are thinking of going into education one day or counseling, I am more than happy to stay after and talk a little bit about the work that I do in that sense as well. So we're talking today about stress. Can all of you hear me? I really, using this just feels like I can do it if you need me to. But can you hear me?
Yeah.
Okay, cool. I teach at a university, so I know how to carry my voice. But if you can't hear me, please let me know. So we're talking today about stress. And you know what? If I could actually rebrand this, I wouldn't call it stress coping, because my intention is for you to not just cope. I don't want you to just be coping with stress. I want you to cultivate and develop stress resilience. That's really, really what I want. It is hard being a teenager these days. And I actually grew up here, and I went to what is now Cathedral, but it used to be Uni. And I remember back then the pressures of getting good grades and getting into a good school, good college, and feeling like that one test that I took and the grade from that one test is going to impact everything, and spiraling into serious panic over these things. So I'm a recovering stress and perfectionist, stressed out teenager and perfectionist as well. And the thing about it all is that I don't want to be another person that comes in here and tells you to stop stressing about your grades. If you put into a lot of time, just stop stressing about your grades, stop worrying. And the thing about it is that we do need a level of stress, right? Stress can actually work for us until it doesn't anymore. So I want to talk a little bit today about stress, give you a little bit of education on stress and the impact it can have on our body. And let's postpone that for...
In 4 hours, okay.
I want to talk to you a little bit about... what can we be doing instead of stressing so much to the point that it's no longer working for us, okay? So giving you a little bit of education on stress, and then hopefully some real, actual, tangible tools that can help you as you begin your stress resilience journey. And I'm so glad to see parents in here, because as parents, you're walking that journey with our children, right? So before we get started, I want to throw out some words and terms. Stress coping workshop, but stress itself is connected to other words that we might use to relate to our experience, whether it be fear, panic, anxiety, apprehension, butterflies, jitters, angst, disquiet, these sort of things. If you have ever experienced any of these things or had any, raise your hand if you've never experienced any of these things. Universal human experience, to have some connection to here. You're probably here because of that, right? But it is a universal human experience to experience one of these things, or to have some sort of experience of it, whatever it is that you call it. So, a few questions. And I also would love if you ask questions as I'm talking. My hope is that we can be somewhat interactive with each other. And please don't leave me hanging up here when I ask you questions too. Please. So stress. What has stress gotten in the way of? For any of you, give me an example. What has stress gotten in the way of in your life? Yes.
Sleep.
Yeah. So it keeps you up at night. Your mind is going hard to turn off. What else? Yes.
Eating.
Absolutely. So you can either lose your appetite, because when that stress response is turned on, your body has no interest in eating or digesting, right? Or we can sometimes use food as a way to comfort ourselves when we're feeling really stressed. Yeah.
Your mood.
Tell me more. How is it affecting your mood potentially?
It's sort of like just makes it like antisocial or just sort of like depressed.
Yep, absolutely. Thank you so much. What else? What has it got in the way of? Yeah.
Sometimes when you're trying to stay focused,
you kind of get distracted by what is the energy. Yeah, so seeing energy, your homework, trying to concentrate, all of a sudden you're lost in that thought process, or you sit down, the test gets put out in front of you, and you're like, I cannot remember anything. And you just feel that like flooding of like feelings and thoughts of like, I'm not going to do well. And then all the stuff that you did study seems to have immediately disappeared. Sports, right? I've had experience of like going out to perform and all of a sudden feeling like all that practice has just gone out the window. Okay. How has stress worked for you? What is the utility of stress? Like how has stress helped you? Yeah.
Help me procrastinate, all of a sudden, be like, oh, I'm
going to
stressed,
and
I need to do work.
Right, and so, and when that sort of like triggers on, you get like hyper-focused, and you're able to actually get it done.
Yeah, like sometimes do your best work when you're stressed out.
Yeah.
Or under pressure.
Yeah. Absolutely. Yeah. Yeah. Stressed about this and have some worry or some stress of wanting to do this well, so now I'm going to recall what I was taught, what the teacher said, what someone shared. Yeah. Any other ways in which stress has worked for you? What does a life with too much stress look like? Close your eyes for a second and like imagine what a life, if you were to imagine like the stressed out person, what does their life look like when they wake up in the morning until they go to bed at night? Like, what does that life look like? Yeah?
I feel like even though like when that person is stressed, it affects like the people around that person. It's like you might like someone smiles at you and you don't want to smile back, and that definitely affects other people.
Absolutely does, yeah. So, I know on my stress days what it kind of looks like. I wake up and everything is rushed. It's like there is some like marathon I'm running against myself to get somewhere, to get something done. I'm rushing my children. I'm barking orders at my husband, you know, and I'm probably missing moments of possible connection through that process, right? What else does it look like? What does that person's health look like? Potentially. Maybe they're not eating or eating too much. Irritable bowel syndrome, okay? Like literally, like you're like, let's just put it out there. Like your stomach, have you ever felt that? It's like not just butterflies. It's like your stomach is like crunched like that. And imagine the effect of that after so long, right? Yes, I said the word bowels. But stress, it affects all areas of our life. And what does a life with less stress look like? What do you imagine that might look like? Can any of you imagine it? Some free time. Right. So you actually have like time and energy for play, for pleasure. You're probably having more connections, right? You're noticing those possibilities for connection. Yeah.
Well, it's like calm, and you're not always like rushing everywhere, and it's not as crazy.
Yeah. Things are calm. You're not rushing, so you're not me in the morning, just trying to get everybody out of the house quickly. Trying to, yeah. So you're able to sort of slow down a little bit. And the reality is that sometimes you do have to rush, right? Sometimes there are times in our life where there is more stress. And what I think, what my hope is that this did a little bit quickly, is took stock of the fact that stress sometimes goes past its threshold of working for us, right? We don't want to throw it out the window. We don't want to get rid of it. There are a few people that I know, or that I can imagine, that have literally no stress in their life. Like they don't worry about a thing. And that might be some sociopaths and 1 or 2 year olds sometimes. A little Neanderthal sometimes. Doesn't have very many views. And we shouldn't use that as our model for how to live our life, right? So we do need some stress and worry when it works for us. But there's a threshold that it can pass in which it no longer is working for us. And my hope that we can talk about a little bit today is how can we sort of develop the mindfulness to be able to notice when that's happening. So that stress is working for us and against us. I have a weird question for you. Why don't zebras get ulcers? Anybody read this book? It's actually the title of a book.
No.
It's a really great book about the impact of stress on human beings. So ulcers are, this is distracting, the zebra right behind me, so I'm just gonna, but just keep imagining the zebra, okay, and I'm gonna move on to the next. But we're gonna talk about the zebra and why the zebra doesn't get ulcers. Ulcers are a stomach condition that some relate to long-term stress or experiencing a lot of stress over time. And zebras don't get them. And we wonder why. And the thing about it is that we all have a stress response, just like zebras do. But zebras, for example, let's imagine you're on the savannah, the zebra eating some grass, and sees a bush rustling. That stress response might turn on. And what that's gonna allow for the zebra to do is to what? Hyper-focus on this bush. Is this a predator? Is this something to be feared? Is this a potential danger? Let's imagine that it is a lion. What that zebra's gonna do is its body is gonna do everything it can to get it away from that danger, that predator. It's going to up its heart rate so that it's pumping blood to all of its muscles. It's gonna start breathing faster so that it's getting oxygen to its muscles. It's gonna turn off its digestive system, reproductive system. Like, we don't need to worry about digesting our lunch while we're trying to get away from this danger. Let's imagine that it works. The zebra gets away. Okay? Once that zebra is gone, or once the zebra is away from the predator or the danger, it turns on its rest and digest system, its parasympathetic system, which allows for all those other things that were turned off to turn back on. Digestion, relaxation, its heart rate slows down, its breathing slows down. And that works. It got it out of the danger situation, and now its body is functioning again. And the zebra isn't worrying about the lion from yesterday that came out of the bush. It's just worrying about eating its grass, right, and following the herd. As humans, we have a different experience. You can be sitting in your car in traffic, or just sitting in your car. You can be sitting in a classroom. You can be sitting here right now, sitting at the dinner table, and that stress response is turned on. You're worrying about, we have the capacity to worry about all sorts of things. But we're not turning that system off. And the impact that can have on our relationships, for our bodies, for our functioning, can be really, really devastating. The thing about stress is that we all have it. None of you raised your hand when I asked if any of you didn't relate to any of those words, right? It's a universal human experience, so we are all going to experience it. But it's meant that the stress response itself is meant to work for us, not against us. Our sensitivity to stress depends on a few things. Four things, I would suggest. What do you think they are? What do you think that our individual stress coping, stress resilience, like what does that depend on? How stressed out we get? What are some examples of things you think it might be related to? Yeah?
Any time?
Time? Yeah, so like allowing for time to go by that you can actually work through it. But what do you think, like, what are our inner workings made of that can, yeah?
Hereditary now?
Genetics? Yeah. Sweat, yes.
Life experience?
Absolutely. That's like number three or four down here, but I don't want to give them all away, so I'm not going to click it. But yeah? Yeah.
Our environment, like who we surround ourselves with.
Yep, absolutely. Yeah. Let's talk a little bit about genetics. This is why I'm so glad the parents are here today. Like, how our parents, grandparents, and ancestors experience anxiety is going to affect, you know, biologically how we cope with anxiety. Another thing about this. We as parents can't teach our children to be better than we are when it comes to dealing with these things. It is like a hard truth that I have had to acknowledge and I daily am looking at and having to work with. We don't have that to offer, right? We could sit with our child and tell them how they should be thinking, and what they shouldn't be thinking, or why they shouldn't be worrying, or how they should deal with it. We could sit and talk with them about this. But then if we go and they watch us doing something different, where are we going to learn more from? What we sit and tell them, or how we are responding to our own stressors in our life? That's what they're watching. That has a million times more impact than what we actually sit and tell our children. So we have to walk this journey with them and own our imperfections in it and walk that journey with them in building stress resilience. Brain chemistry. Oh, adolescence. I mean, we know. I've been there. And it's, yes, I mean, just that life cycle stage developmentally is difficult, right? So you have pressures of school, the pressures of friends, the pressures of parents, the pressures of culture, cultural messages, getting into college, also being at the stage where you're getting ready to launch and seeking independence. There's no question that it's just a hard stage to begin with. But then we look at adolescent brains, and the part of the brain that is the fear response part of the brain, that's like looking for fear and reasons to be stressed out, the amygdala, it is very developed by adolescents. But our prefrontal cortex, the part of our brain that works with executive control and calm reasoning, it's not as quick to the developmental show. It doesn't develop as quickly. So you are fully capable of calm reasoning and executive functioning, of course. But it's a little harder because your fear response is ramped up because it is like super developed. And that part of our brain is not as developed quite yet, which makes it just harder. It's just stopped working. Okay. So the type, amount, and movement of the chemicals working in your brain is affecting stress. The unique brain of an adolescent puts them more at risk. Life events. The situations you're faced with in your life, no doubt. Personality. How you look at and interpret things that happen to you. What is your capacity for cognitions? What do you think about? Like, where do you tend to catastrophize things? Are you sort of a black or white kind of person? All these things play a part. Before I go any further, I'm going to talk about perfectionism now a little bit. This is a quote from one of my favorite researchers, Brené Brown. and I connect with it at a deep level. I'm a recovering perfectionist and an aspiring good enoughist. That would be me. Perfectionism is the belief that if we live perfect, look perfect, and act perfect, we can minimize or avoid the pain of blame, judgment, and shame. Even if you don't really relate to this idea of perfectionism, and you know, I'm not really a perfectionist, it's still relevant, and the reason is because we are growing up in a culture of perfectionism, of perfect. The photoshopped, filtered world of this is how you should act, this is what the perfect life is going to look like, and this is what you should be striving for. So either way, I think that it's important and relevant. What perfectionism really is, though, it's like this big old shield. Like if I act perfect and I seem perfect, then nobody can see how vulnerable I actually am or how I really feel like I'm struggling. Perfectionism is just fear in really fancy shoes. That's what it is. Most perfectionists were raised being praised for their achievements and performance. So grades, manners, rule following, people pleasing, appearance, sports. But somewhere along the way, adopting this really dangerous and debilitating belief, I am what I accomplish and how well I accomplish it. I won't ask you to raise your hand if you can relate to this. I just want you to sit with that for a little bit and wonder, do I believe that about myself? That I am what I accomplish and how well I accomplish it? And then that's where my worth comes from. Let me tell you something about worth. And I'm gonna wrap up with worth as well, but I feel like I gotta say it right now too. There is no, I promise you this, there is literally no prerequisite for your worth. We can get really stuck in this idea of, if I get into this college, if I'm accepted by these friends, if I win this championship, then I will be worthy. Then I have worth because I accomplished this. Worth is literally your birthright. Like, you have worth no matter what it is that you accomplish. There are no prerequisites for that. But that is a sticky thing to trust, because we adopt this belief that we are what we accomplish and how well we accomplish it. We've been praised for our grades, our rule following, our sports achievements, what we've done, and then all of a sudden we believe that that's who we are and all that we can be, and that's just not true. So I'm not gonna sit up here though and tell you don't strive for things. That's not what I'm trying to say. But there's a difference between perfectionism and what a perfectionist does and what drives a perfectionist and healthy striving. Perfectionism is exclusively externally driven. What will they think? Healthy striving is internally driven. How can I improve? It is you setting a goal for yourself based on what you want to achieve and accomplish. A big difference there. So what does stress and perfectionism potentially lead to? Distressing thought, emotional pain, physical ailments, disconnections, destructive actions potentially. So our minds try to respond to this in two ways, but I'm going to offer you a third option. But to illustrate this, I'm going to have us do a little activity. So what I'd like you to do is pair up with somebody, and one of you either needs to have a piece of paper or a notebook, preferably a notebook or notepad if you have one. If you don't, paper is fine. Pair up with somebody with one of those objects. Right now, please. We'll bring our voices down once we find our partner. that piece of paper or notepad or notebook or whatever it is represents your pain, okay? Or represents your fear, or represents the thing that you're worrying about the most. Oftentimes, what that feels like is, I need one of you in that dyad to have pick up that piece of paper or notepad, put it right in front of your face, and turn towards your partner. Okay? This is what it commonly feels like. You are like fused with your fear. You can't see through it, you can't see beyond it. Your anxiety, your worry is so consuming that it's right in front of your face. And let me ask you this. If I was to ask you right now, with all that worry and fear right in front of your face, if I was to ask you to write a paper, drive a car, study for an exam, give a friend a hug who was hurting, how well would you be able to do it with that right in front of your face? How connected do you feel to the person in front of you? It would be difficult, right? But this is what it feels like. But that doesn't work, right? So what do we try to do? We want to avoid it. We want to not think about it. So now what I want you to do is get that piece of paper and put it in front of you, hold it forward, and I need your partner to push up against it. Okay? So this is the other option we know we're given, right? We don't want to be fused with it. We want to avoid it. We're going to keep it at an arm's length. We want to toss it out the window, and we've tried that, and it just literally doesn't work. I promise it doesn't work. You can't get rid of it. You don't want it. You don't want to be that sociopath or two-year-old toddler, right? You need some of that worry. So we keep it at an arm's length. We try to avoid it. And that works for a while. Like, it might be a little bit easier right now, potentially, to drive a car, give someone a hug, connect with somebody, study for an exam, perform in a sport performance. It might be a little bit easier, but anybody's shoulders starting to hurt a little bit? You're really doing this. After a while, you're going to feel this. You keep it at an arm's length, but not for long, because you know what? Have you ever heard of this thing, don't think about a pink elephant? Do anything but not don't think of a pink elephant. If I was to say, don't have that thought, gosh, just don't think about it, don't worry about it, just stop worrying about it. That pink elephant and that thought gets what? Bigger and bigger and bigger until you are consumed by the pink elephant and consumed by the thought, and guess where it is? It's back here again. Right? So here's the third option. Take that piece of paper and put it in your lap. You want to toss it out the window because it's painful and it sucks and it gets in the way of things. And we can't, and we don't want to, because we need some of that to help us focus, to keep us in line sometimes, keep us safe. But when this is in your lap, and you bring it along for the journey, and you are in control of that destination, your hands are free, right? So you can do other things. You can drive a car, you can perform. You are in control. So, two ways in which our minds usually respond. Fusing with it, like you can't see through it, you try to avoid it, but that just usually leads back to this. But this is the third option, okay? And we're gonna talk a little bit about how we can cultivate that. So, physical symptoms of stress. Some of you mentioned it, and I use the word bowels in here and talk about digestive systems and how our stomachs can create that butterflies or stomach aches. What are some other physical symptoms of stress that any of you have ever experienced? Yes?
Hair loss.
Hair loss, absolutely. Nobody's ever said that when I asked that question, but yeah.
Headaches.
Headaches?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Heart racing.
Absolutely. Heart racing, yes.
Bite your lip.
Bite your lip, okay, so like develop habits. Yeah.
Shortness of breath.
Shortness of breath, absolutely. Yeah.
Exhaustion.
Exhaustion, yep. Any of you ever get that feeling where like your extremities get cold or your face gets like super hot, like all the blood rushes to your face, like that feeling? Doesn't feel good, right? So all of you grab a piece of paper as you were walking in, and what I'd like you to do is there's a little desk connected to each chair, so open that up, And what I would like you to do, depending on your method of doing this, you can either draw it or just write it out. I want you to imagine yourself standing in your room. You've just woken up, looking out of your room into the world, and I want you to list or draw out two things. When you think about what you have to do that day, and you begin to stress about that, write down, I want you to take stock of what are the physical symptoms I'm experiencing so that we develop an awareness of that. And then I want you to list all the things that you're worried about for that day. Let's take stock. So can you take about 5 minutes and either draw it, if you want to draw it, or write that out. The physical symptoms, and as you're standing in your room looking out into the world, imagining all the things that you are worried about for that day. If there are some things that are too sensitive, use a code word. Use a word that feels safe, that you know what that represents. So we're going to take about 4 or 5 minutes to do that. Really putting yourself in this place. Where in your body are you feeling these things? Picking stock of the stresses in your life. We often are moving so fast, we don't slow down and actually list those things out and look at them. I love that some of you are drawing it. Y'all are still writing. You got some long lists of stressors, don't you? Some of you may still be working, but a few questions I want to pose as you look at this list of the impact that it's having on you physically, what it actually feels like, as well as what you feel like you have to carry that day, what you're walking into that day with your list of stressors. Looking at your list, I want you to ask yourself a couple questions. Is this stressor an internal one? Is it coming from something outside of me? Is it an external stressor, an external pressure? Is it an internal pressure? Is it real? Like, this is something that's really happening? Or is it imagined? Or is it a what if? Or is it sort of imagining the possibility of something happening that isn't even actually happening, but you find yourself worrying about it? Would anybody be willing to share when they sort of look at their list and looking at what they feel like they're faced with during the day? What comes up for you when you look at this? Do you feel like you have the capacity to take this on? And that's okay, nobody needs to answer because it's personal. My hope today, and we're going to get to it real soon, I promise, is giving you some real tangible tools for how to put some of this in its place. Identifying things that don't get to control, don't get to take up space in your life that day. The worry's still going to probably show up because as human beings, we literally don't have the capacity to subtract memories or worries. What we can do is have a thought, have the third, have the worry, and be able to put it in its place where we're still in control. We still decide whether that's going to take our energy, and our time, and our actions. But if you're still working on this list or you're drawing, and I really do, there's something about, even if you're not an artist and I'm not, drawing that piece and sort of drawing what those stressors look like that I think can be really therapeutic. So something for you to do maybe at a later time. But this is us taking stock of what these things are so that we can begin to really look at them in a non-judgmental, but mindful way of its effect on us in our lives. So really quick, intervention versus prevention. Why should we practice stress coping skills before we find ourselves in a stressful situation? Why do we brush our teeth before we get a cavity? Like, there is so much utility in practicing some of these skills when you're not stressed. Because when you're stressed, your capacity to really engage in these skills that you haven't been really practicing and working on, it's going to be really hard because you are that zebra trying to run away from the fear and the worry, and your capacity to be able to slow down and do some of these things is harder during those times, which is why you can sort of put the effort and the work in before you're in that stressful situation. Let's discover some tools. I like cheesy mnemonics, so just bear with me through it. It helps. It makes it easier to remember, so when you're in that moment, you're like, okay, what was that? B-O-L-D, bold. And it sort of helps us in these stressful moments slow down and think through what are some steps I could do right now. Don't be annoyed. The first one's breathing. Feel like, and maybe it's just me. When I was in my training, and when I was, you know, working on myself, I think every therapist should have a therapist, because that's when you're taking care of yourself first. And people were like, okay, now we're going to talk about breathing. I was like, really? Breathing again? But it wasn't until I really put it into practice and began to think of it differently that I really noticed that, no, it's not the end-all, be-all answer. It is something that's going to ground us and center us so we can do the other work that's hard. Okay, so yes, the first one's going to be breathing. I'm going to talk a little bit about what kind of breathing. Breathing deeply and slowing down. O is going to be observing. This is where we develop, cultivate mindfulness. So like mindfulness, you hear that thrown around, that word thrown around all the time these days. So I'm going to talk about what I actually mean by mindfulness. How do I actually think it's going to be useful? Listening to your values. So we're going to talk a little bit about that. And deciding on actions and doing them based on your values, based on like what's actually important to you. Remember perfectionism and healthy striving? Healthy striving being you actually doing, you making your own goals and having that being internally driven. This is where we come back to values and what's important to you. Let's talk first about breathing. Who here has heard of belly breathing? Some of you didn't raise your hand, so we're still gonna go into it a little bit. Breath is something we do all the time. We are doing it right now. And breathing is important, right? Remember when I talked about that zebra, I talked about, and some of you mentioned sort of like fast breathing, like just trying to get oxygen to your muscles. Fast breathing and breathing from the chest is connected to that stress response. When we breathe deeply, I'm going to walk you through it in a little bit. When we breathe deeply and we push air like deep into our diaphragm and into our belly, it actually like pushes on and touches nerves that are connected to that parasympathetic system. It's like biological. It actually really triggers that parasympathetic opposite of stress response system, rest and digest system. It really triggers that. And for all the other things that we're going to be doing, it's going to ground you. It's going to anchor you. Okay? And it's something that you can do at any point, right? You can do it whenever. We're always doing it. So you can be doing it. Nobody needs to know that you're actually doing it. But it really actually does work. So what I'm going to ask all of you to do, I'm going to walk you through a little bit. We're just starting from the stage one, right? Just breathing. If all of you could put your hand on your chest and your stomach. And you don't need to change your breath right now, do nothing different. Begin to notice where your breath goes. Do you feel your chest moving or is your belly moving? Just breathe normal right now. But is your chest moving or is your belly moving? For most of us, it's our chest, right? That's usually where our breath sort of stops. We're going to bring it a little bit deeper, because remember, we want to slow things down and center ourselves, and we literally are going to be pushing up against that, some nerves that are connected to that parasympathetic opposite of the stress response. So I want you to begin to send your breath a little bit deeper. And the goal, the hope, is that our chest actually stays still and our belly rises and falls with our breath. So see what that feels like. Imagine that there is a balloon in your stomach that you are pushing air into, and you feel it expand, and you feel it inflate, and then you experience it. Perfectionists in the room might find themselves beginning to struggle with, I'm not doing this right, or the critics in the room, the ones that are judgmental towards themselves or others, are like, this is weird, just breathing, just trust me on this journey a little bit. And when you begin to notice yourself judging how you're breathing, notice that, give yourself a little bit of grace. Maybe this is the first time you're breathing this way, and let it go. Can we all take 10 of these breaths? And I'll do it with you. Yourself feeling awkward, just stick with it. I'm back to your breath. Feel your heart rate slow down a little bit. Oxygen is pumping to your brain, allowing you to think more clearly. Maybe you want to take a nap. That's okay. Okay. Come back to your normal breath. I'm going to have you do this again in a little bit and put something else tied onto it. But let me talk you through it a little bit first. Actually, first, let me ask, what was your experience of that? People are nodding. Yeah. What was your experience of it? Yeah.
Really relaxing.
Really relaxing. Anybody feel uncomfortable? Yeah.
I feel like I have to stop my chest.
Yeah. So it takes practice, right? Like your breath kind of gets stuck in your chest, and then you find yourself focusing so much on that you sort of lost the intention, right? That's where grace comes in. Just sort of allow yourself to know this is a new way of breathing, and I don't need to be doing it right away. There really is no right way as long as it's working. But it takes practice. Anyone else? Anyone feel like it was almost really hard to get their stomach to move a little bit? I experience that sometimes too. So now we're moving into the observing piece, mindfulness. With breath and with mindfulness, the goal actually is not to get rid of the thoughts and the worries. Weirdly, this is the truth. It is not the goal to get rid of the thoughts and the worries. And it's actually not the goal. It's not the goal, to get rid of the thoughts and the worries, to get rid of the stress. The breathing and the mindfulness is about slowing down and beginning to notice the thoughts and the worries. It's developing a sense of an observing sense of self, a part of yourself that can, once you practice it a lot, can do this pretty quickly, of being able to step outside of yourself and say, literally watch yourself as you're doing it. Watch yourself as you're having the thoughts or the worries, noticing what's going on, what's keeping you from being able to study, take the exam, perform, connect, these sort of things. So we're gonna do another little exercise right here. And it's called watching the waves. What I'd like all of you to do is, again, close your eyes this time. Put your hands on your chest and your hand on your belly. Begin by just noticing your breath. And then begin to send the breath a little bit deeper. Y'all are doing this great because there's so many yawns and yawning. It's really triggered a rest system. It's great. So sending your breath deeper, feeling your belly rise. Your attention is on your breath right now. Now I want you to begin to shift your attention from your breath to your thoughts. Just begin by noticing the thoughts that pop up in your head. We are constantly having thoughts. Some are weird and silly or have no major consequence. Some thoughts we find ourselves getting swept up in. with me as I take you for a little visual, okay? I want you to imagine that you are standing on the beach at a shoreline. And the waves are lapping against your feet. The tide comes in and the tide goes out. And I want you to imagine that you're able to place your thoughts onto the waves. So you have a thought, you see that thought go onto the wave, you feel it come, slap against your feet, and then you watch it wash away. Let me give you a few minutes just to sort of try this out. You might find yourself getting swept up by thought, maybe the thought of some sort of distraction, or what you have to do later today, or feeling uncomfortable. That's okay. I just want you to notice that you have that thought, that you got swept up by that wave. Give yourself a little bit of grace, because that's okay. And allow that wave to wash away and to go back with the tide. Keep practicing this for a little bit, please. Just noticing the thoughts. And now we're going to add to this. As a thought that you're placing on the wave washes up, slaps against your feet, or feels like it takes you with it, and you watch it wash away, I want you to label the thought. So for example, let's say you have the thought that, you know, she looked at me kind of weird today. Like, I wonder if I made her upset. Did she become a bad friend? Did I turn that thing in? Did I put it in my book bag? Did I answer that question correctly? Those kind of thoughts, maybe label them worrying. So place a label onto the thought. Watch it wash away. Maybe you're thinking about what you have to do after this when you get home. I would label that planning, potentially, and then let it wash away. And then feel your feet in the sand again, grounded. Your breath is grounding you. Perfectionists in the room, we can't think of the perfect label. That's okay, just label it thinking. Okay. Go ahead and let your breath return to normal and open your eyes. The purpose of this exercise is to begin to cultivate this experience of being separate from your thoughts. It's a weird concept, right? It's like, I'm not my thoughts, who am I? But our brains have incredible capacity to have all kinds of crazy thoughts. Or thoughts that are distressing, or imagines, all sorts of things. But just because you have a thought does not make it real, does not make it true, does not mean that you have to now do something because of that thought. Your behavior does not have to follow that thought. I love this sort of metaphor of being on a road trip. Remember when you had a piece of paper and I said you're putting it in your lap? Let's imagine for a second that you're on a road trip of life. And on this road name that piece of paper, which is stress, worry, perfectionism, fear, and as well as joy and all these other things are coming, creativity, all these other things are coming along this road trip as well. You're in the car with all these things, and you're like, all right, you've come on this road before with me, so I know you're coming again. But there's a couple of ground rules. I'm driving. I know you're gonna have opinions about what I should be doing, how I should behave, how I should act. But I'm not gonna listen to you unless I think it's gonna be connected to something that's important to me. You have no say over what music we listen to, you do not get a map. You never, ever, ever get to drive the car. This is a metaphor from Elizabeth Gilbert's book, Big Magic. She talks about creative living. It's a really good book. It's an audiobook for those of you who like audiobooks. And I love this metaphor because there's you, and then there's all these thoughts and worries. But you the person, beginning to see yourself as being separate from those things puts you back in the driver's seat, and you're in control. You have the agency. You get to decide, do I have to do what this thought is telling me or is leading me to want to do or to believe about myself, about others, about my relationships, about what I have to be doing, my performance? Does it? So let's talk a little bit now about values. Values are chosen life directions that bring purpose and a deeper meaning to one's life. They're different than goals, but they're really important in terms of helping us. They inform our goals, but they are different than goals. Values are here now, goals are in the future. Values should be freely chosen and never need to be justified. So when we all assume, like I imagine that all of you would assume that you have values, but we never really like sit down and think about what they actually are. So I'm gonna play a little video for all of you that I think illustrates values versus goals even better than I could. And following this, I'll talk a little bit more about how can we really begin to identify what our values are, because we all know that we have them, but how often do we actually sit and think, okay, what are my values? And then look at it and decide, is this really something that's important to me, or is it something that's important to someone else? Because that's really important to distinguish. But let's watch this for a sec.
Society tells us the way to be happy is to achieve our goals. Get that great job, earn that money, get a good body, find a partner, have happy, healthy kids, have a big house, have a nice car, have holidays. Go, 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 go. And it's true that if you do actually manage to achieve these goals, then there is a little moment of joy and happiness. But how long does it last? How long before you're looking at the next goal, and then the next goal, and then the next goal? And as we live our life trying to constantly strive to achieve these goals, one after the other after the other, how tiring and exhausting does it get? Is this you? There is a radically different way to live your life, which is a life based on values, a values-focused life. It's like two kids in the back of a car, and it's a three-hour car journey to Disneyland. And the first kid is totally goal-focused. Are we there yet? Are we there yet? How much longer? Are we there yet? This journey of frustration, it's all about the goal. The second kid is values-focused. He's got the same goal. He wants to get to Disneyland. But he's also in touch with his values around curiosity, adventure, having fun. So he's looking out of the window, playing I Spy with my little eye. He's counting all the you know, the interesting farmhouses that he sees on the way. He's spotting interesting farm animals, cows and sheep. He's noticing different types of trucks and cars on the freeway. So he's actually appreciating the journey as he heads towards his goal. Now, they both reach Disneyland at the same time. They both have a fantastic time at Disneyland because they both got to achieve the goal. But the first kid had a journey of frustration. The second kid had a fulfilling, rewarding journey. Then on the way home, the first kid, are we home yet? Are we home yet? Are we home yet? All about the goal, all that frustration. Second kid's looking out of the window, noticing how the world looks different at night, spotting the lights in the farmhouses and the cat's eyes on the freeway. The car breaks down on the way to Disneyland. Now, both kids are really disappointed because neither of them achieved their goal. But the second kid at least had a fulfilling journey up until that point. Now, when the pickup truck arrives to tow them home, the first kid, oh, it's not fair! I want to go to Disneyland! How long before the car gets repaired? It's not fair! It's not fair! The second kid starts to notice how the world looks different when you're sitting in the front of a pickup truck high above the level of the rest of the traffic. So this is the very important distinction between the values-focused life and the goal-focused life. In the values-focused life, we have the fulfillment and satisfaction of living our values every step of the way towards our goals, the satisfaction of achieving our goals, and the fulfillment that comes of living our values even when we don't achieve our goals.
And so you heard, you probably saw something up there about ACT. So ACT stands for Acceptance Commitment Therapy, and it's, in terms of my work that I do, part of my sort of theoretical orientation of working with my clients. Let's get back to here.
So, can you give a sense of the difference between goal-oriented, which we think sounds good, right, being goal-oriented, but the difference between that and values-based oriented? The values-based person is actually in their life and living their life and noticing the process and enjoying the process. And hopefully getting to those same goals that are informed by what's important to them and feeling having that healthy striving. But not so dead set on that goal that they get in their own way, or get stuck, or aren't happy. So how do we clarify values? There are several ways that we can clarify values, and I have several interventions that I use with clients to do that. And this work, let me say this, an hour and a half is like, I'm just introducing parts of these pieces. Like this is real intimate work that people can and often need to do with themselves, with each other, with their families, to really be able to cultivate. But how do we clarify values? We can look at our fears and our worries almost as allies here. Our fears and our worries, sometimes, it's a weird idea, seeing them as an ally, but our fears and our worries oftentimes show us what we actually really care about. So looking at what you're afraid of, looking at what your fears are, your anxieties are, and your worries are, what do they remind you is very important? So you don't have to sit and write this out right now, but think of this question, and please do this at some point. Ask yourself. Sit down and write down what your values are. Another one that I like to call the sweet spot. So vividly recalling a really rich, sweet memory. So I'll sit with my clients and I'll say, okay, close your eyes and just go back to a memory that is just gives you all the good feels. Like one of those things that is just such a sweet memory. And I'll have them go back to that moment and really imagine it. And I want them to get in touch with those emotions and to really bring themselves back to that experience. What is meaningful about that memory? Why Why was that so sweet? Why did that feel so good? What do you value that we can pull out from that memory? Because I find that people do have a really hard time identifying what their values are. Another thing that sometimes you can do is ask, it's much easier for us to identify what others might say about us or what we value. And so I'll ask, let's imagine that people were celebrating you and giving a speech about all the things that you stood for and all the things that you represented for them. What would some of those things be? And then I really want to look at those values and make sure and clarify that this is your value. This isn't coming from anywhere else. You don't have to justify it to anybody, but it needs to be your own. Otherwise, it loses its strength in motivating you when going gets tough to reaching some of those goals. So this is going to sort of bring us into the action piece, right? So once we breathe and center ourselves and put thoughts in its place and identify what's really important to us, now we can get to action, actually doing something different or doing something. And I think this is a good segue into that. I am willing to have blank feeling, right? So some of these things that we're going to be striving for are going to bring up worries and anxieties. But are you willing to bring that along that road trip with you? Are you willing to say, okay, I'm accepting the fact that you're coming along for this ride and you're in the car with me, worries, fears, anxiety, perfectionism. I know you're going to pop up from time to time, but I don't have to believe everything you say. But I am willing to have those feelings. I'm not going to do the avoidance thing. I'm putting it in my lap. Remember, your hands are free. I'm willing to have blank feeling in order to blank, do something you care about based on your values. So fill those blanks in for yourself. You don't have to say it out loud, but I'm willing to have fear, I'm willing to have anxiety, I'm willing to have this thought or these worries in order to blank. What are you wanting to do? Are you willing to bring along some of those fears with you while putting them in their place, right? You are not those thoughts, you're separate from those things. So getting into action. Setting goals that are specific. So when we do talk about goals, right? Because we still should have end goals. We just want to be enjoying our life in the process as well. But set goals that are really specific, realistic, time-framed, achievable. And please, by all means, let them be meaningful. Why are you doing it? Why is it important to you? If it's not meaningful to you, those goals, when the going gets tough, and it will get tough, you're either going to get out of the game and not achieve those goals, or you're going to destroy yourself health-wise and mental health-wise doing it. When you feel yourself resisting, remind yourself why you're taking specific actions. Remind yourself, okay, I'm trying to do this because it's going to further my values, further what's important to me. This is why I'm going to stick with it, even when it's hard. Think of the benefits of achieving your goals. Be real, okay? So imagine, what are some things that might get in the way? Plan for these things. Prepare yourself. And seriously, by all means, have fun while you're doing it. When we look at values, we want to look at different things. We want to look at what we value in relationships, in our work life, in school. We want to look at what we value in terms of our physical health. What do we value in terms of relationships, spirituality? And we often, way too often, forget what do we value in play, and what do we value in pleasure and in having fun and instilling some of that into our life. Because without that, It is really hard to show up for the other stuff. So let's talk a little bit about connection. So when we experience anxiety, stress, worry, perfectionism, this all tends to fall under this like bigger umbrella called of shame, feeling shame for something. Feeling shame that you're worried about this, you didn't do this well enough, not sure if you're gonna do it well enough, you made this mistake, feeling shame. What we know from some research about shame is that if you were to put shame in a little petri dish, and you were to throw in isolation and secrecy and keeping it to yourself into that petri dish, it would fester and it would grow and it would be all consuming. It would just get out of control. If in that petri dish with shame we threw in connection, like owning our story and our experiences and sharing it with the right people, okay? Because not all connections are created equal. The right people at the right time. Shame hates that. It can't grow when it's shared with the right people and through connection. So I'm going to show you a quick video about the difference between sympathy and empathy. And how to really take stock of who are the people in my life that I know if I came to them with my worries, they would show up for me. There's different kind of friends or people in our lives. There's these are the ones that maybe aren't the best to connect with, right? And we want to take note of who are the people that we can and can't. There are the people that can take you sharing your experience, your worries, your fears with them, and they want to silver line it. You know, it's like, oh, well, at least you have this or that. Or there's the people that aren't okay with you being imperfect and are like, no, you're totally exaggerating, it's not that bad, you're amazing, you did amazing, I'm sure it was all great. And you're like, oh, can I just like own the fact that I'm feeling bad about this, I messed up, or... And then there's the people potentially that take the opportunity to maybe like one up you, you know, and they're like, oh, that's not bad at all, this one time this happened to me. And it's like, I just want to connect with you right now, and that's not useful either. There are the folks that feel shame for you. It's like, oh, that sounds really bad. That's really, really bad. I can't believe you did that. That's so bad. And you're like, no, that's not helping. Not helping me right now at all. So there's different kinds of, but then you know what? There are the folks also in your life, and you have to just take stock of your connections and who are these people in your life that you can share these worries with so that it doesn't fester and become something bigger. The people in your life who will see you in all your imperfect, beautiful glory, connect with you on some level of, you know what, I've actually felt this before too. I'm so sorry this happened to you. I'm so glad you told me. And I love you. You know, I'm not trying to fix it. I'm not trying to find someone to blame for it. But seeing you in your whole self, your authentic self, connecting with you through that, I'm not trying to fix it, but just saying, I'm so glad you told me, and I love you, and how can I support you? So we're gonna watch a little video that can illustrate this, I think, in a creative, cool way.
So what is empathy, and why is it very different than sympathy? Empathy fuels connection. Sympathy drives disconnection. Empathy, it's very interesting. Teresa Wiseman is a nursing scholar who studied professions
very diverse professions where empathy is relevant and came up with four qualities of empathy. Perspective taking, the ability to take the perspective of another person or recognize their perspective as their truth. Staying out of judgment, not easy when you enjoy it as much as most of us do. Recognizing emotion in other people and then communicating that. Empathy is feeling with people. And to me, I always think of empathy as this kind of sacred space where someone's kind of in a deep hole and they shout out from the bottom and they say, I'm stuck, it's dark, I'm overwhelmed. And then we look and we say, hey, calm down. I know what it's like down here, and you're not alone. Sympathy is, ooh, it's bad, uh-huh. No, you want a sandwich? Empathy is a choice, and it's a vulnerable choice, because in order to connect with you, I have to connect with something in myself that knows that feeling. Rarely, if ever, does an empathic response begin with at least. I have it, yeah. And we do it all the time. Because you know what? Someone just shared something with us that's incredibly painful, and we're trying to silver lining it. I don't think that's a verb, but I'm using it as one. We're trying to put the silver lining around it. So, I had a miscarriage. At least you know you can get pregnant. I think my marriage is falling apart. At least you have a marriage. John's getting kicked out of school. At least Sarah is an A student. But one of the things we do sometimes in the face of very difficult conversations is we try to make things better. If I share something with you that's very difficult, I'd rather you say, I don't even know what to say right now, I'm just so glad you told me. Because the truth is, rarely can a response make something better. What makes something better is connection.
So whether we are taking this information from a place of ourselves and trying to take stock of who are the people in our life we feel like could show up for us in that way, or whether we're taking it from the perspective of as a friend, how can I show up for somebody else in this way? Or as a parent, how can I show up for my kid in this way? Because what we do know is that when we don't show up for people and have this kind of connection, from empathy and love, that's when stress and worry and fear and shame and anxiety and all these things fester and grow into something that might not feel manageable anymore. So I'm so glad that I was invited to come and talk to all of you parents, but like the students, like if you can figure this stuff out now, so exciting, because then you don't have to figure this out later on when you have families and kids and these jobs, and adulting is hard. Being an adult is hard. So if you can figure all this stuff out now, look at your values, develop these sort of skills, grounding yourself and be mindful of things that are happening, knowing when to reach out and connect when you need to, when it's too much, when you need to share your story with someone, your fears with someone, work on that now. Develop that now, because I'm telling you, it doesn't get easier. So, sort of to recap, stop, breathe, and think. What I hope you can take from this is this sort of summarize. Finding ways to be able to slow down, anchoring yourself with breathing. So that means practicing it, like setting aside time every day to
practice it.
Setting time aside every day to practice the breathing, because when you are in the stress mode, it is really hard to remember what was that deep breathing? Like, you won't be able to do it. You have to put in the, like, you have to, like, do the work first and practice it and physically feel how that feels so that when you really need it, you can pull from those practicing, that practice, that experience. Slowing down, anchoring yourself with breathing. Treat yourself with the same compassion you treat a friend or loved one. If someone that you loved came to you and said, I'm going through this experience, whatever it is that you're experiencing, what would you tell them to do? Treat yourself with that same compassion. Connect with the right people. Don't do it alone. Don't isolate yourself. It's going to fester. It's going to become something greater and bigger and worse. Share it with the right person. Let them know what it is that you do need from them to support you. Remind yourself why you are doing this. Why? Healthy striving, remember? It's based on you and what it is that you actually want and your goals and your values. That'll keep you in the game when it's hard. Are you willing to still do it and bring the uncomfortable feelings with you on that journey? Bad news is I can't, there's no pill or magic wand or any technique of getting rid of those thoughts completely. Remember, we don't want to. Remember, stress can actually help us. But are you willing to still take steps towards your goals based, informed by your values, with those uncomfortable feelings coming along that you're driving? And I just want to end on worthiness. Worthiness is waking up in the morning and saying, no matter what gets done, what gets left undone, I am enough. Yes, I was imperfect. Yeah, I was even afraid. But it doesn't change that I'm also brave and worthy of love and belonging. That's literally your birthright. You have the right to be loved. You have worth. You're worthy of belonging. No matter what gets done, what gets left undone, you're enough. That's all I got for you.